Yeah, so I'm going to talk about theory of equilibria. So game theory, what does it do? It does analysis and design of a system where people are interacting, rational, let's call them rational agents, with their selfish goals. And so let's take an example. It's called game of chicken, where on a single lane path, two cars are heading onto each other. And both of them have only two choice. Only one car can pass. So either both of them head on and collide, or they can change their course and go into a field or a side path or whatever, and then they cannot go forward where they were heading to. So if you look at the payoff, of course, both of them want to go straight, but then they're going to collide, and that's an accident. That's a really bad outcome for both of them. If both of them change their course, then nobody is going forward, nobody is happy. In the other two cases, one of them is happy, whoever goes straight is happy, and the other person is not happy. Immediately, you can see that these two outcomes are undesirable, and these two are okay outcomes. At least one of them is happy. And so this is kind of an analysis of a game scenario. And traffic light is a mechanism which achieves one of these two outcomes. And that's kind of a design part of it. So in particular, I'm going to talk about games today. So in our games, there are going to be players. And players have strategies. Rock, paper, scissors is one example. Right? So everybody knows the game, rock, paper, scissors? Or do you want me to explain what the game is? OK. So there are two strategies. Either play rock, paper, or scissors. And once both the players chooses their strategy, the payoffs are decided. Let's say it's a win-lose game. The loser has to give $1 or 1 rupee to the winner. Would you, if you are playing this game, do you want to choose a strategy deterministically? Do you want to play rock or paper or scissors? If you want, I really want to play with you. So no, we would like to randomize, right? We don't want our opponent to guess what we are going to play, right? And so randomization is essential, not only in this game, but in many important games. And Nash proved that once you allow randomization, not in only two-player games, but many-player games, a stable state exists. What does a stable state mean? That no individual player wants to change their strategy, and they can improve. Okay? No unilateral deviation. That's the stable state. And the way Nash proved this theorem is through a fixed point theorem by Brouwer. So the fixed point theorem says that if you start with a disk, by disk I mean a compact convex set, and the function is continuous, and but it's still over the disk. So it takes every point from the disk to itself, to the disk itself. Then there is a point which is fixed by the function. F of a is a. And this essentially fixed points will be the Nash equilibrium. That's how he constructs the function. Okay? But what about computation? This is completely existential theorem. It doesn't tell us how to compute this fixed point. And the computation question is not only like CSV started asking this question. Immediately after Nash's theorem, people started asking this question, how do we compute the Nash equilibrium? Even before, actually, this Nash equilibrium. For special cases of game. Nash proved it in more generality. And there were many, many algorithms, but for the algorithms for the most general case are, so these are economists, mathematicians, they never cared about running time of the algorithm. And for the most general game, the algorithms we have are through fixed point theorems, and so they suffer from numerical instability on all these issues. Within CS, when we started asking this question, first thing we saw was that it doesn't seem easy. Okay, so then we think of complexity classes. Can we show hardness of this problem for some complexity class? And the first thing that comes to mind is NP. But for NP, there always exists a solution. For Nash, the solution, for NP, we ask whether there exists a solution. But for Nash, the solution always exists. So this question is irrelevant in that sense, because the answer is always yes. Okay. So then we are in the regime of total function problems within NP, where existence of solution is guaranteed. Okay? And Megiddo and Papadimitriou showed that if Nash is NP hard, then NP equals co-NP, because Nash is both in NP and co-NP. Okay? So, the later Papadimitriou defined this PPAD class and showed that it is kind of between P, NP and P, and PPAD is not short form of Papadimitriou, it's a polynomial parity argument for directed graph, although it resembles very well. So, the problem in PPAD, canonical problem is this. You have a graph, every vertex has at most one in degree and at most one out degree. So, you can imagine this graph is essentially set of paths and cycles. You are given one endpoint of one of the paths and asked, give me any endpoint of any path. You know there exists one because this path which has a starting, which is given to you, has an ending, right? So, you know that there exists a solution, but give me any solution, I'm fine with that. Now, you can say that, oh, I'm going to check every vertex. No, but there are exponentially many vertices and graph is given by a circuit succinctly. So, there are two circuits, predecessor and successor, that tells you, given a vertex, it tells you who is the predecessor and who is the successor. Okay? So, you can't just do enumeration. And showed that Nash is in the PPAD. Okay? Now, our focus is two-player game. So, let me describe how we're going to represent the game. Let's say our two players are row and column. It will be clear why we call them row and column briefly. So, we're going to represent, when they play, we kind of think that the row player is choosing a row of some matrix and column player is choosing a column of that matrix. The corresponding, so there are two matrices, corresponding entry in the R matrix is the payoff of the row player and corresponding entry in the column matrix, C matrix, is the payoff of the column. Okay? So, that's the representation of the game. Is this clear? Because I'm going to use this part again and again throughout the talk. Is the representation clear? Okay. Okay. So, now the problem of two Nash is finding a Nash equilibrium in a two-player game which is represented by two matrices R and C. If the number of strategies of the players are M and N, then these are M by N matrices. Okay? Now, what about algorithms? So, we have from 64 a very nice path following type algorithm which is kind of simplex but not essentially simplex. The pivoting is complementary pivoting. It always finds a Nash equilibrium but worst case is exponential. Now, for complexity, it was shown that it is PPAD complete in 2006 and at the same time even approximation, one over Pauli approximation was shown to be PPAD complete. On a positive side, constant approximation, we have a quasi-polynomial algorithm, so QPTAS. Rank 0, that is a zero-sum game. Your loss is my win and my loss is your win. Okay? So, sum of the payoff of two players is always 0. Then you can just solve it through LP, which was known even before Nash proved his theorem by von Neumann. Okay? And then there has been a lot of work for special cases ranks. Rank of the individual matrices are constant, rank of R plus C is low. For this, we know approximation or sparse, which is work by Siddharth, and so on and so forth. And there is a lot of work on query complexity, communication complexity, which Yaakov will talk about, which I haven't listed here. So, this is just for communication. And then we know that the constant approximation, we cannot beat this if we assume exponential time hypothesis for PPAD. And similarly, if we now try to optimize something over the Nash equilibrium, like give me a best approximate Nash equilibrium in terms of payoff, or give me a Nash equilibrium where this strategy is played with non-zero probability and so on, any such decision is can't do better than quasi-polynomial assuming exponential time, the standard exponential time hypothesis. So, and all of these algorithms that we know are kind of enumerative. Using the properties of the game, you restrict the search space and then enumerate. So, whenever they are solving for one Nash equilibrium, essentially they are also solving the decision problem, whatever you want. Okay? So, the first question I want to ask is, are there efficient non-enumerative techniques to solve this problem? And the second question I want to ask is, can we get some kind of hardness that are kind of unconditional? okay. And I have, my talk is divided in two parts. First part, I'll kind of talk about the first question, the second part, the second question, okay. So the first part, I'm going to describe a method which is based on a linear program and one dimensional fixed point, and it solves the game when rank of R plus C is 1. Remember, rank of R plus C is 0, that's a zero sum, that's LP. R plus C is 1, so zero sum has convex set of solutions because it's LP. Rank 1 can have exponentially many disconnected Nash equilibria. So immediately the complexity goes like haywire, but still we can solve it. Rank 2 and beyond is hard. So this is threshold that Kavita was also mentioning about k equals 1 to k, so somehow you could just get it. And then the second part, I'll talk about this another algorithmic framework, which is sum of squares, which I'll try to convince you that it's pretty strong, powerful framework, and then prove some lower bounds against this algorithmic framework. Yes.
Basic question, how do you measure the complexity in terms of rank of R plus C? Because the game essentially remains the same even if I scale just one of the two matrices, but the rank is going to be drastically
change. Yeah. So you can ask this question, and there has been a recent very nice work on finding equivalent games. So if you are give me a game, can you tell me is there a rank 1 game which is equivalent to this? And that's a very valid question. Rank is fragile in that sense. But this is basically motivation was because we can do rank 0, can we do rank 1? And there is a fundamental difference between rank 0 and rank 1, convexity with versus exponentially many disconnected equilibria. And yeah, that's a separate question that is very valid. Yes. Okay, so the first part. So again, back to our game. Now, as we just discussed, that players would want to randomize. So let's say the randomized strategy for the row player is X, and randomized strategy for the column player is Y. Okay, so this X is m-dimensional vector whose entries are non-negative and they sum up to 1 because it's a probability distribution over the rows, and Y is a probability distribution over the columns. Okay. In this case, the expected payoff of these players is this vector matrix vector multiplication, right? You can just see this. And then the Nash equilibrium is just no unilateral deviation. So once they play X and Y, individually row or column player doesn't want to change their strategy. Okay. So what does this mean? Okay. So let's fix column player to playing Y. Now row player will think, okay, if I play my ith strategy, what is the payoff do I get? Now remember, Y, column player is playing Y, so she gets Rij, the ijth entry of R matrix with probability Yj, because that is the probability, Yj is the probability of playing column J for the column player, right? So this is the expected payoff from playing from the jth cell, right? So if you take the summation, then that's the expected payoff from playing ith strategy against Y. So let's, this is just ith coordinate of this Ry vector. Okay, so the maximum payoff she can achieve from playing an individual strategy is this quantity, right? So Ei is just the unit vector with ith entry 1. And if she wants to achieve this maximum payoff with any randomized strategy, she cannot achieve more than this maximum, individual maximum, right? If you have a set of numbers, and if you put a probability distribution over that number, you cannot achieve more than the maximum in that set, right? So the maximum she can achieve is this. So checking whether X gives the maximum payoff is equivalent to just saying that it is better than any individual strategy, pure strategies, right? And this can be done only if she is playing a strategy with non-zero probability whenever it gives maximum payoff. So the strategies that are played with non-zero probability, they must be giving the maximum payoff, right? You have to put non-zero mass only on the maximum numbers, then only you can achieve that maximum, right? Okay, so this is the characterization. And this is kind of a complementary slackness type of condition. And a variable is non-zero only if some constraint is tight, right? So using this, let's define this polytope that capture the maximum payoff. So let's say pi r is the variable that captures maximum payoff of the row player, and pi c is the captures the maximum payoff of the column player. So just see that pi r will be only more than the maximum payoff for any fixed y, right? And pi c will be more than the maximum payoff for the column player, right? Okay. So now suppose I take a point in the product polytope of this p and q, and look at this objective. What is the first term? This is the sum of the payoffs of both the players. What is the second term? The second term is the sum of the at least the maximum payoffs, right? So this, can this quantity be positive? This can never be positive because this is more, this term is more than this term always, right? So this is at most 0, and this is exactly 0 when you are at the Nash equilibrium. So this gives us a nice simple quadratic program which is maximizing this objective over this product polytope. Okay, and now you see why you get an LP for a zero sum game. When r plus c is 0, this bilinear term, the difficult term vanishes, everything else is linear, and you get an LP, right? Okay, so this is the problematic term. If your game is rank 1, then again this simplifies to product of two linear terms. Okay, still it is a rank 1 quadratic program which is in general NP hard. So we cannot just rely on existing techniques for solving QPs. Okay. So what we do is, let's first use minimum information we need for representing the game. So if we have R, U and V, I can reconstruct the matrix C, right? Because that is just U, V transpose minus R. So U and V is just rank 1 matrix. It's a U matrix, column matrix, multiplied by a row vector, right? So that's the rank 1 matrix. And do this replacement at both places in the objective, in the polytope. Okay. After that, I'm going to look at not only one game but a space of games where I allow any vector instead of U. Okay. So instead of U, I have a star, so I do that replacement in the objective and in the constraint. Now this is more complicated because now this is like a 3 variable in some sense, right? Because star is also a variable in that sense. So I replace that difficult term with a lambda. And now you see this is kind of a parameterized linear program. Well, lambda is the parameter. Once I plug in some value of lambda, it's a linear program. Okay, and what can I show for this linear program? If you look at all the solutions of this linear program for all possible values of lambda, they exactly, nothing less, nothing more, exactly capture all Nash equilibria of this game space for all of these games. Okay, and we can show this through complementary conditions. Complementary slackness condition of this linear program matches with the complementary condition for the Nash equilibrium characterization. In particular, what can we show is that if you plug in lambda, you get some solution for this LP, then corresponding x and y is a Nash equilibrium for all c. So instead of u, I have a vector c such that x transpose c is lambda. So instead of finding solution, a Nash equilibrium for one game, I get a Nash equilibrium by solving one LP for a space of games, which is m minus one dimensional space, right? Because this is m variables here. But I am after this R, U, V and not any R, C, V, right? If U belongs to the space, then I'm done. So now what we have is, we have this parameterized linear program where we plug in lambda, we get X and Y. If lambda, then I'm done, right? So what should I do? Just put a box around this. Think of it as a function, which is inside is a single parameter function, takes a lambda, inside solves the LP, computes x and y, outputs x transpose u. If x transpose u is lambda, then we are done. That's a fixed point of this function, right? And fortunately, we know how to solve one-dimensional fixed point. That's just binary search. So if you have a function from a 0, 1 to itself, then you know that if you don't have a trivial fixed point at 0 and 1, then 0 will belong to this upper half, and for 1, the function value will belong to a lower half, right? So this gives you two pivots. Between them, the function is continuous. I know that, right? Because it's a solutions of a parameterized linear program. And then you just do the binary search. And we know that the precision of a Nash equilibrium is finite, actually polynomial in the bit length of the game. So we're going to be done in polynomially many iterations. Okay. And that's it. That gives us an algorithm. Okay. So it would be interesting to see if this can be applied to, we did apply this technique to other Nash equilibrium computation problem in other games, but can we apply it to other quadratic programs, let's say, which are coming from some different domain? It would be interesting to see that. Okay, so that second part is some bad news. So I'm going to focus on applying sum of squares algorithmic framework on Nash equilibrium. What is sum of squares? It's basically SDP based, hierarchy based method. And many state of the art algorithms for optimization problems has been using this powerful technique. It has helped break integrability gaps, it has helped get state-of-the-art approximation algorithms, and so on and so forth, for really classical important problems. So we were hoping that maybe something can be done using this, and we really honestly started with a hope of a positive result, not a negative result, but we ended up with a negative result. Again, when we tried to apply this framework to Nash, the first roadblock was NP versus PPAD. So far it has been applied to optimization problem, the formulation was like that. How do we kind of get rid of optimization and just want to kind of solve a search problem? Okay. So here is our attempt. We tried to define this algorithmic framework. So this is the definition of Nash equilibrium, right? You want to find vectors x and y such that they satisfy these inequalities. And now these are polynomial inequalities, they are not linear because of this bilinear term on the left hand side. And what is an approximate, epsilon approximate Nash? So it says that a player can deviate and gain, but no more than epsilon. That's an epsilon Nash. Okay. And now if we do linear relaxation of this, that means here we have a quadratic terms here, right? Xi times yj. If we replace those xi times yj by variables, say pij, then we get a linear relaxation of the system which captures correlated equilibria, if you know about it. If you don't know about it, don't worry. Okay? But you don't get Nash equilibrium, but you get something which is correlated equilibrium. Now we want to do more, we want to build this hierarchy on top of this by doing this relaxation, but higher order. So what is, I'm going to define degree D pseudo distribution, okay? It's not a distribution, it's a pseudo distribution in the sense that it's going to be defined by its expectation operator, okay? What do I want from this expectation operator? That it is linear. It has a variable for these higher order monomial terms, okay? So instead of just replacing xi and yj, xi times yj by pij, now I'm going to replace xi times xj times xk by say pijk, and I'm going to look at all degree d monomials and introduce variables for them, okay? And on top of that, I have to make sure that everything makes sense, so I have to introduce all the symmetry constraints and whatever the other important constraint is, that the normalization constraint, that the expectation is of 1 is 1. Non-negativity constraint, that if you take any polynomial q of degree less than or equals d over 2 and take a square of it, then the expectation of that has to be non-negative. So that's why sum of squares in some sense. And then this expectation has to satisfy my important polynomials by this. If you want that p greater than or equals 0, the polynomial p greater than or equals 0, then you introduce all of these constraints, that expectation of q square times p, where degree of q square times p is less than equals d, is non-negative. Okay, so this is how it is defined. This essentially captures up to degree d moments of your the final distribution you are after. So degree D pseudo equilibrium is degree D pseudo distribution that satisfies, say, Nash equilibrium or epsilon Nash equilibrium constraint, whatever we are after. Okay. And you can see that if you just take D equals 1, you get, or it should be D equals 2, sorry, it's a typo. If you take D equals 2, so degree 2 monomials, if you only replace degree 2 monomials, then you get correlated equilibrium polytope. If you go all the way to degree n and higher, then you get back the Nash equilibrium. Okay? But you can see the size of your this program exponentially increases with D, right? If you have, let's say, degree D, then your size is n to the D, if n is the original set of variables, right? So you don't want to go all the way to n. So the algorithmic framework we work with is kind of oblivious, is information theoretic. So you have, you get, your system gets this degree D pseudo equilibrium. You never get to see the actual game. Okay? Somebody computes this degree D pseudo equilibrium and gives it to you. Using this, you can take as much time as you want, as much space as you want, and whatever resources you want, you do some kind of rounding. But you can only look at this distribution and not at the actual game. After that, you generate set of solutions, or say, let's say one solution, and then verifier will tell you whether this is actually an equilibrium or not. Okay? So that's how it is information theoretic. Instead of, and then we also allow partial solutions, where you don't have to give like entire equilibrium, you can give one of the player's strategy, and we can complete the other player's strategy, that's fine. And not only one solution, but an array of solutions, okay? So degree D, query Q, oblivious rounding with verification oracle algorithm will take degree D pseudo equilibrium, do whatever rounding it wants in whatever time and resource it wants, generates Q queries for possible solutions, gives it to verifier, and if any of them gives you a Nash equilibrium, I'm happy. Okay, so the framework is clear because I'm going to prove lower bound against this framework. Okay, this system never gets to see the game. That's important. Okay, because if I give you the game, this part will generate the solution, right? Because there is an exponential time algorithm there. Right? Okay. And we observe that many or most algorithms that we knew for using SOS fit into this framework. So it is strong enough in that sense. Okay. So first, because we were aiming for some kind of positive result, we could reconstruct the QP task. And we were not the first one. We realized that just before us, somebody had used SOS framework to come up with a QP task, which we already knew from Lipton, Mehta, Markakis that Tim mentioned using, they actually gave a QP task, the first QP task for Nash. So what the main theorem we show is that if you are aiming for a 1 over poly n approximation, then either you need D to be omega n or you need the queries to be exponential. Okay, so either way you are going to hit the exponential running time. And if you are looking for a constant approximation, then D has to be, either the D has to be log n or the query has to be n to the log n. Okay? So we can't beat, using this framework, we can't beat the state of the art.
Can you remind where is
well, yeah.
Where is wrong?
So here this, you, once you get the pseudo equilibrium, this oblivious rounding algorithm not only generates one solution, but let's say Q solutions. And this is the query part.
So, 2 to the n, you can just generate.
Yeah, you can generate 2 to the n if you wish. So, these are the final theorems. And essentially, it's saying that this particular framework doesn't allow you to beat the state of the art. So high degree pseudo equilibrium does not give you any information about actual equilibrium. That is what we want to achieve. Okay, so let me go to the proof. I have 15.
So
that
particularly about 1 over n to the 4
or is it
more general
polynomial? Yeah, we prove for 1 over n to the 4, but I think we can bring it down to 1 over n square if we do more optimization into the analysis that we did. But it would be interesting to see if we can do say 1 over n to the c for any c greater than 0. That is the hardness result. For PPAD hardness of Nash equilibrium, it says that any given c greater than 0, getting 1 over n to the c approximate Nash equilibrium is PPAD complete.
Structured classes that are greater, like the eta's will lower and
spark. That's the next open. And it's super interesting to me because I'm trying to look into that. Yeah. Yeah, Tim.
So, it is sufficient to the
Yeah, there is a Q for this.
So it's two ways. One way, like,
sorry. Yeah. So the qubitas we have doesn't need to enumerate. It's just the SOS, solve SOS, and then generate the solution. Q is one. Yeah, otherwise you just do LMM. Structured classes, like let's say rank of R plus C is constant, or let's say it's a sparse game where. So this is general games, right? Like, okay, so let's go into the proof. So the main idea is to construct a family of games. We'll have to construct a family of games because we want to also have hardness against this enumeration. So we're going to construct a family of games that all share a common pseudo-equilibrium, but all of their approximate equilibria are disjoint. Actually, they are far apart. Okay? And that's our goal. Okay. So essentially, the pseudo-equilibrium contains no information about Nash equilibrium, and we know such instances for classical optimization problem like 3-sat, K-click, and so on. And another thing we know is that once you have such a problem, if you can map that problem to another problem that has a low degree mapping of solutions as well, then the hardness also carries forward. Yes. Sorry? Yeah. So I'll just say that if Nash equilibrium sets of any two games, they are disjoint and there is some gap between them. I'm going to restrict them to a nicer set, and these sets are disjoint.
Pseudo-equilibrium,
it's
not.
Yes.
Not
like
a.
No. I don't allow pseudo-equilibrium, but I allow you to choose whatever Nash equilibrium you want. So the Nash equilibrium sets are going to be disjoint. It's not as if these games have different set. At least one Nash equilibrium is different. No, it's all Nash equilibria are disjoint kind of in both of the player strategies. If you are going to use the SOS framework as a black box, then you will have to allow to be any pseudo-equilibrium to be used, right? Unless you do some more tweak to it. Okay, so this game construction, we'll first talk about the meta game construction before we go into the details of the two theorems. It has two parts. One is the SOS hard game, which has. What we want from this game is that it has a degree D pseudo-equilibrium with very good payoff, but all of the epsilon Nash equilibrium payoff, not only Nash equilibrium, epsilon Nash is a bigger set than Nash equilibrium, right? All of its epsilon approximate Nash equilibrium has really poor payoff, the sum of the payoffs, okay? Degree D pseudo-equilibrium has the payoff delta for both the players, while all epsilon Nash equilibria has the total payoff of both the players at most 2 times delta minus epsilon. Okay? And then enum hard game, which is a family of games which are defined by subsets of the strategy set, such that all of their Nash equilibrium set are disjoint basically. Okay, so we make sure that each of these games, so if you take a subset of the of these numbers, then their Nash equilibria are around the uniform distribution over that set. Okay, US stands for uniform distribution over that set of strategies. Okay, so all the epsilon Nash equilibria are constrained in this epsilon tau epsilon ball around this point, and so they are essentially, this makes sure that they are disjoint. Okay, and then you construct this, combine these two games, where you put, there are two blocks, first block and the second block, red block and the blue block. Red block contains the information about the pseudo equilibrium, and the blue block is this Enneum hard game. And the way we construct it, it is important that what you put here, okay, because what we want is that this part, the red part, does not have any equilibrium. Okay, whatever equilibrium are there in R and C, we want to kill them. Okay, so we show that this game has degree D pseudo equilibrium in the red block, but all its epsilon Nash equilibria are in the blue block. Okay, so the red block, the first block, does not contain any Nash equilibrium or any approximate Nash equilibrium. Okay, and then the theorem we can show is that if you have these subsets S1 through SQ through which you construct these Enneum hard games, and then you have this one SOS hard game, then you construct this family of games using these two, where you have common first block, which is this SOS hard game, and then using Enneum hard game, you construct these blue blocks. So these games just differ in the blue blocks, not in the first red block. Okay, red block is common over all of these games. Then all of these games have a common pseudo distribution or pseudo equilibrium in the red block, but all of their Nash equilibrium are in the blue block and they are disjoint. So this essentially gives us the hardness, right, lower bound, because I am allowed to give any pseudo equilibrium. So if I give the pseudo equilibrium here, and then does not give you any information about the blue block. It could be there, yes, but yeah. Yes.
So in a sense, you're saying that even the support of any pseudo equilibrium tells you nothing.
Nothing about it. Yeah. So the pseudo equilibrium essentially will tell you set all of these strategies corresponding to the blue block to zero. Okay. All of their moments will be zero. But still, your equilibrium are in the second block itself. There is no equilibrium in the first red block. So for the exponential lower bound, we construct the SOS hard game using the K-independent set. So there is a reduction from independent set to game by Guilbeault and Zimmel, and we extend it to get hardness. Not only to like mapping solutions to Nash equilibrium, but also to approximate Nash equilibria also gives you independent set and so on. The property is that if there is an independent set, then there is a Nash equilibrium with payoff 1. If there is no independent set, then 1 over n square approximate Nash equilibrium has payoff less than this whatever we wanted. And then we have Enneum hard family. This we do using matching penny. You basically have to restrict that the players only play this strategies from set S. You set really bad payoff for the rest of the strategies, and then it's basically like only identity matrix for this part, and then they will have to really randomize even if they just care for approximate solution. Yes. This one. No, so it's that's the gap, right? So if there is an independent set, so this is the payoff of both the players individually is 1, and this is the total payoff of the, thank you, yeah, Okay, so I'm rushing through the details, but yeah, essentially this is an extension of Gilboa's ML reduction from independent set to approximate Nash equilibrium, and this is a construction through matching Penny, extension of a matching Penny game. And for the quasi-polynomial Lowell bound, we did have to do more work. So there was a result by these guys, I can't pronounce the first name, Fernley and Savani, assuming strong exponential time hypothesis, order one approximate max payoff NE is hard to compute. And so we extended it to get what we wanted, that if basically using this, so they start with this what they call free games. So from there you want to construct a two-player game where omega log n pseudo equilibrium, there is a omega log n pseudo equilibrium with payoff at least one for both the players individually, but actual equilibria have payoff at most 2 times 1 minus epsilon for epsilon, some constant epsilon. Again, the constant is not too great. It's I think 1 over 500 or something. So it's not nice. and then for the Enum hard game, we extend the construction of the Skalakis and Papadimitriou, which is much more complex. I'm not going into details, but essentially, we show that we can construct this n to the log n many games such that for every game USI, its Nash equilibria are restricted to 2-8 epsilon ball around the uniform distribution over set SI, and the for any two games, their uniform distribution corresponding uniform distribution are at least 17 epsilon apart. So these two sets have to be disjoint and combine them to get the final game. So essentially, I showed you this very nice technique. This is an old result. This actually, I did this here during my PhD. And this is a relatively new result. I'm still working on this. So we defined this oblivious framework with using SOS of oblivious surrounding with verification oracle, which is kind of information theoretic. And we using this, we could find essentially just using pseudo equilibrium, not even enumeration part of it, a non-enumerative qubitas, but showed lower bound for the actual questions of finding 1 over poly n or constant approximation. And as a consequence, we extended the results of Gilboa Zamel and the Skalakis and Papadimitriou for some settings. Okay. And open questions. So somehow we are stuck for constant approximation. I guess we are stuck at still 0.3393, right? I haven't seen any improvement after that. So we know a polynomial time algorithm for epsilon equals 0.3393. No better than that polynomial time algorithm. So that's, it would be really interesting if any kind of SOS framework or SOS algorithm gives you better than 0.3393 approximate Nash equilibrium. And let's say, can we do some kind of beyond worst case type of analysis using this framework, or maybe special classes, can we do better than the state of the art algorithms? Yep. That's it. Thank you. Questions?